to the west on the 13th floor. This movement was enough for the girder to walk off of its support at column 79. The unsupported girder and other local fire-induced damage caused floor 13 to collapse, beginning a cascade of floor failures down to the 5th floor. Many of the floors had already been at least partially weakened by the fires in the vicinity of column 79, and this left 79 with insufficient lateral support. As a consequence, the column buckled eastward, becoming the initial local failure for collapse initiation. Now, Professor, I have no, you know, advanced schooling in physics. I'm a practical guy. And I'm sorry, my bullshit director goes off, a detector, when I read this. Because in simple terms, they're claiming that the epicenter here was floor 13. And if that's the case, there would be a huge pile of unmelted, unbroken steel above the remains of floor 13 and the areas below.
That's absolutely right. And so that gets us back to that problem of the debris field being so tiny and being so short.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So again, back to this point, that if people know what the official story... See, most of these people say, well, of course I accept the NIST report. They've never read the NIST report. The people who knew something about the August report don't know that they changed the final report to make it allow for free fall.
Mm-hmm.
And so people are signing on to believe miracles without knowing it, and then ridiculing people who question it because they can't stomach those miracles.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's the situation we're in, where we've got ideology combined with ignorance combined with indifference, and of course you know the old joke, you know, which one's worse? I don't know and I don't care.
So in closing this segment here, I want to come back to the final three words of your subtitle, why the final official report is unscientific and false. Take a moment to explain.
Yeah, because they simply violate the basic principles of scientific method, which is the two that I mentioned. You cannot falsify data, you cannot fabricate data, and then thirdly, the really big one, you cannot ignore data.
Mm-hmm.
And the first half of my book is about all the data that they ignore, the testimonies of explosions going off in Building 7 as well as the towers, the testimonies about molten steel under Building 7 as well as under the towers, the evidence of all sorts of things in the World Trade Center dust that shouldn't have been there, things that show that we had temperatures up to over 4,000 degrees Fahrenheit when fire couldn't have gotten even to 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit and certainly couldn't have heated steel anywhere close to that temperature, and yet there's evidence that steel melted. We have iron, which is a residue when steel is melted, say, with thermite. And then the most recent, the big discovery, that there was a nanothermite in the dust, lots of nanothermite, and nanothermite, whereas ordinary thermite is an incendiary, it starts fires,
mm-hmm.
Nanothermite is also a high explosive and a very powerful explosive indeed that ordinary mortals cannot get hold of. You have to be, it seems like only the military and people related to the military have this stuff. And NIST simply said NIST was asked by Stephen Jones and other people who were involved in this study, well, did you check the dust for thermite? And thermite is a class term. It includes nanothermite as well as ordinary thermite.
Mm-hmm.
And they just said no. And then when a reporter asked Michael Newman, the spokesperson for NIST, well, why didn't you check for thermite? Why didn't you check for explosives? He said, well, because there was no evidence of that. And she says, appropriately, how can you know there was no evidence if you didn't check for it? And he said, if you're checking for stuff that isn't there, you're wasting your time and the taxpayers' money. So that's the level of intelligent response you get when you ask these guys any question about it. So they just ignore. So it's unscientific from beginning to end. I quote a former employee of NIST who said that NIST has been completely hijacked from the political, from the scientific into the political realm, so that the scientists there no longer have any scientific independence. They have to say what they're told to say by the Commerce Department, by the National Security Agency, and by the Office of Management and Budget, which is a political, is an arm of the White House.
And I would call what you just described circular logic, but that's not fair to logic.
That's right. It's not even circular logic. It's just circular. So, and then the fault is, you know, I go in that there is a distinction between being unscientific and false, but in this case, there's no distinction because the same evidence that shows it's unscientific shows it's false. And by the way, for anybody who wants to know and say, well, you know, Griffin is just a philosopher, philosopher of religion, who's dealt a little bit with philosophy of science, how is he qualified to say these things? Well, because I can read, and I can read scientists who say these things. And if you look at the blurbs, you'll see I've got several scientists, including and also engineers and architects, endorsing this book.
And Dr. Rosie O'Donnell, too.
And Dr. Rosie O'Donnell, who probably knows a lot more about Building 7 than most of her detractors.
Really?
Oh, yeah. She
Good
was hot on this. In fact, kept bringing it up on The View. And I was all scheduled. I was one day away from making my plane ticket reservation when she sort of got off the show. I mean, she did resign, but she was harassed.
They Van Jonesed her.
They Rosie O'Donnell Van Jones or something. So anyway, I would have been on there on national TV talking about all these things a year ago if that hadn't happened. And so, given the fact that I did ask Rosie if she would endorse the book, and she said yes, and Rosie knows what a blurb is. She wrote a very short blurb. She says, David Ray Griffin has written a powerful book that asks disturbing questions and seeks to debunk myths about September 11. It is provocative, well-researched, and beyond convincing.
Yep, I concur. The book is out in soft cover, $20 from Olive Branch Press. Again, the full title, The Mysterious Collapse of World Trade Center 7. Why the final official report about 9/11 is unscientific and false. And for our listeners, we have initiated a new interactive system here where you can call in and, using voicemail, contribute questions and comments to the Peter B. Collins Show. We just got it up a few days ago, and so we didn't get any calls in that are on topic for Dr. Griffin today. You can use it, though, if you want to send us a comment about the interview. We might include it in a future podcast. You're always welcome to leave comments there. And the toll-free number is 888-5-PETER-B. You dial 1-888-5-PETER-B, 888-573-8372. I did get a couple of questions by email for Professor Griffin. These two are from Craig, who is familiar with your book, God, Power, and Evil. And he has two questions. Can you comment on 9/11 and your undertakings in terms of theology and theodicy? And number two, does this nation lack someone with a suitably charismatic, social, spiritual, progressive persona who could strike deep chords of across-the-culture, humanly spiritual resonance within us? That's an interesting question.
Actually, I think there are many of those people. The problem is that they cannot get mainstream coverage, and you cannot get a mass movement going, or at least it's very, very difficult unless you get mainstream coverage. And almost by definition, the mainstream is not going to give airtime to someone who might do that sort of thing. Back to the first question. In my work in philosophy of religion, I had two major areas for most of my career. I focused on the problem of evil and then the relation between science and religion. So as I indicated a second ago, I did do a lot of work in philosophy of science, which helped with this book. But the evil, I think it also helped in the sense that I still am amazed. I talk to so many people who are very worldly people, and they know what